What kind of relationship does a PA have with the pathologist? What sort of interactions do we have together? I'm going to tell you what kind of interactions a pathologist has with a pathologist assistant so you have a better idea of how a PA fits into the healthcare team. So day to day, there can be a lot of interaction with how much a pathologist assistant and a pathologist work together, but there are three main areas in which they do work together quite a bit. First is frozen section, second is on complex surgical pathology cases, and then thirdly is during autopsy. Firstly, frozen section. So either the afternoon before or the morning of, a PA will look through the OR schedule for the day. They'll look for any cases that seem like they'll be coming for frozen section, note any previous pathology results from those cases, note them down, and then pass that schedule on to the pathologist. When a frozen section comes, there's not usually enough time to do this, so a PA will go ahead and do all this ahead of time. Then when one of those cases arrives, the pathologist may or may not handle it directly. At some sites, it's preferred that the PA gross and handle the fresh specimen themselves while the pathologist just observes, like a breast case sent for gross margins. It's typically the PA who will cut through the tissue, select a relevant area, measure the distance to the margins, and then report this to the pathologist. From there, the pathologist can then report it to the surgeon. Or in other cases where a pathologist does need to look at a slide, it's going to be the PA who grosses the tissue, selects a portion of it to get turned into a frozen section slide, will prepare that slide, and then give that to the pathologist. Now, during this frozen section process, PAs are definitely most helpful when multiple specimens come in at once or one after the other. It's much more practical and cost-effective to have PAs gross, measure, photograph, identify, and label margins, lesions, and submit tissue for frozen section than it is to have multiple pathologists doing the same thing. And in these cases, the pathologist is relying on a PA to give them the best representative tissue sample so they can report that back to the surgeon. And the next area we work most directly with pathologists is on complex surgical pathology cases. Typically, when a PA is grossing a very complex case, maybe there are unusual anatomical structures in place or that aren't usually seen together, or if there are multiple concurrent pathologies going on in the same tissue, or even if you're unfamiliar with that type of specimen, it can be useful to call a pathologist in to look it over with you. And usually when you call them in, it's useful to be able to go over what you're planning for your dissection, areas that you're considering sampling, areas that you're planning on ignoring, and just making sure your plan of attack lines up with what the pathologist is expecting. It's also a good time to check with the pathologist if there are areas that they are most interested in. Are there areas that they want you to sample very heavily? Or if you're going to map the case, if there are a specific way that they want the tissue cut so that the photographs make sense. And other times you might be working on a routine surgical specimen and something about it just doesn't make sense. Maybe the orientation is a bit off, you can't get a hold of the surgeon, and so you'd like to show the pathologist what you're dealing with. Or maybe there is supposed to be a tumor in the piece of tissue, but you can't find it. In these cases, consulting and working directly with a pathologist can ensure that they're getting all the information they need to sign up the case. And this can make your life easier as well. You're ensuring that you won't have to go back to the case unnecessarily again in the future. Now, less frequently, a surgeon will bring up tissue themselves. Often this is because there's something very specific they want to show you or a pathologist in person. The tissue structure might be hard to visualize after it's been removed, or there might be a surface that they're very concerned about and want to point out specifically as a margin. Or other times they'll point out to you a surface that they may have cut and they don't actually consider a margin. This is common when they've had to actually cut through a tumor to remove it, and they know they've gone back and taken out more tissue after that initial cut. And then once you're done grossing cases, pathologists will sometimes come back to you either for clarification or to give you feedback on the case itself. This can sometimes be related to how you describe things. If it wasn't easy to understand what you're seeing in your gross, they may come back to you and just see if you could better explain what you were looking at or if there's a better way of seeing what you actually saw. And they may too suggest in the future a better or more efficient way of sampling or describing something to make it easier to sign out the case. And then lastly, there's autopsy. Since PAs are the ones typically performing the evisceration for a pathologist, the pathologist might have suggestions or things that they want to see done depending on the previous surgical interventions that had taken place or what kind of pathologies they're expecting to see. And typically, the more of these there are, the more closely a pathologist and a PA will work together, sometimes eviscerating side by side for an hour or more. The PA also advises the pathologist on what they're seeing during their evisceration. Is there a lot of unexpected blood somewhere? Does something like the aorta or heart have a tear in it or something obstructed? These can be important clues as to why someone died, and the pathologist is relying on a PA to tell them what they're seeing while they're eviscerating, as these details can be hard or even impossible to detect after the evisceration is complete. Even though a PA operates behind the scenes a lot of the time, they're an important part of the healthcare team. There's a lot of routine tasks in the lab that a PA can do and a pathologist doesn't need to be involved in. And that's actually a good thing. We don't want to be wasting a pathologist's time in the lab. Pathologists also rely on us communicating with them and sometimes working directly side by side with them to provide the best patient care possible. To learn more about becoming a pathologist assistant, check out this playlist here. And if you haven't yet, make sure you hit the subscribe button. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.